Good afternoon. I will present my research on analysis of approaches to onboard network design. One of the approaches considered is based on SDN. This research is performed in cooperation with Valery Kostenko, Ruslan Smolyansky, and Alexander Shalimov. The onboard real-time information and control systems are composed of dozens of computational devices interconnected by a large number of data exchange channels. Strict deadlines are imposed on computational tasks and messages to be transferred between these nodes. There are also constraints on weight and dimensions of the onboard control system and reliability constraints. Here you can see an example of a legacy architecture of an onboard control system. For instance, we can see a lot of point-to-point channels, some common bus channels, and maybe in some evolved legacy system, we can see some optical high-speed channels, but they are also point-to-point ones. So in legacy systems, we have lots and lots of channels with large complexity and weight. To design such a system is a great challenge. So systems must be simplified to minimize the number of channels and to make the design and operation more efficient. Some modern onboard system may look like this. We have some set of computational nodes interconnected by a switch network. Task migration is supported between these computational nodes, and usually some traffic shaping features are available in the network. We will consider the following types of onboard networks. First, the PFDX network, which is widely used in today's civilian aircraft. Second, a more advanced fiber channel-based network with a real-time profile. And the third one will be based on SDN and OpenFlow. The comparison will be performed according to the following criteria. First, the network must guarantee real-time messages transfer. The requirement of real-time transfer will be later formulated as SLA or service level agreement requirements. Second, the network must be able to maintain common time in the system, because if high-performance computations are to be performed, the tasks in the system must operate in common time. Then there is a dependability-related criterion describing how much extra hardware must be introduced into the system to make it reliable. For example, to make it tolerant to a single failure of a network cable. And the last criterion is related to reconfiguration. The dynamic alteration of message routes is necessary in cases of network equipment failure. For instance, if a link fails, no route which passes this link is considered operational. Then, in case of computational unit failure, some test migration is to be performed, and the data flows through the network migrate with the task. And the last case is the mode change for the onboard system operation. Different operation modes involve different tasks, and mode change requires task migration in some cases to make processor utilization more optimal. Let's describe the SLA requirements in detail. The data flow in the onboard network consists of a set of messages. Each message has its size, sender, receivers, and the generation jitter. For a periodic message, it's period hidden, and for a regular message, which does not have a definite period, a set of deadline intervals is defined. So, our SLA for message transfer includes the following. For periodic message, it needs to be transferred no less than once per its period. An irregular message is to be transferred no less than once per each deadline interval. Any message must be transferred within its maximum allowed transfer latency. We mean end-to-end latency from its sender to arrival on the receiver. And the last requirement is maximum allowed transfer jitter. This picture illustrates the notion of jitter. For instance, if we have some reference instant of message generation, the actual time of message generation may deviate from this reference time. For instance, it can be later, as in this picture, or in advance to the reference time. This is the transfer jitter if we consider message arrival time. The AFTX network is based on Ethernet. It is somehow obsolete because it supports only 100 megabits per second speeds. It requires complete sparing of the network devices. For simplicity, only one of the two independent networks is shown on the picture. The central concept of AFTX is a virtual link. Each virtual link has its static route from one sender to one or several receivers. For a virtual link, there is some way to allocate bandwidths via frame-based traffic shaping, which involves a leaky bucket algorithm. For each switch, we have a single fixed virtual link table. So if the system has several modes of operation, the channels for every mode must be incorporated in this table. So some bandwidth is wasted, because if the system operates in one mode, the bandwidth for other modes is not used. AFTX does not provide the jitter control for message, only for frames, and it does not implement priority system or support for irregular messages. For instance, if we have to support an irregular message, we have to allocate time for it as for a regular message, so some bandwidth will be wasted. Fiber channel real-time profile inherits some key features from AFTX, including virtual links and complete sparing. But it supports several virtual link tables per switch with the ability for runtime transition between this switch, between these tables. So no bandwidth is wasted to support different modes of system operation. But as all these tables must be defined a priori, only a static set of possible task operations is supported. Fiber channel real-time profile supports message generation jitter management. This is available almost over MDX. And it supports irregular messages via priority system. So if you have an irregular message that must be transferred as soon as possible, we assign a high priority to it. And finally, the channel has built-in time synchronization facilities. So what about SDN on the board? Why do we need it? And what are the key features for SDN? First, some known things. With SDN, the onboard network will be managed by an application run on the controller. For time synchronization, a precise time protocol can be implemented. In passive mode of network operation, the rules are generated and loaded to the switches in advance before the system starts. And most of the time, the switches operate autonomously without significant involvement of the controller. In active mode, the controller performs continuous monitoring of data exchange in the network. It is supplied by a non-stepping stream of headers from the switches. And the controller can detect new data flows and generate new rules to support them. Which mode should we choose? From the reliability point of view, the active mode, as it involves non-stop controller operation, is not resistant to failure of the controller. So the controller and the control network must be duplicated. And in passive mode, the system is more tolerant to controller failures, at least if it does not need to change the operation mode. From the configurability point of view, the data flows in the control system are predictable, so we should not expect some new and straight data flows. All data flows are introduced on the design stage. The rules for predefined modes and data flows can be generated in advance, for example, by the controller application. And finally, rules for dynamic mode, for example, failure modes, can be generated even in passive mode, when the controller is activated during the mode change, when, for example, a failure in the network is detected. So, as we think, the passive mode is preferable. The controller application must implement the following features. First, it must construct the rules for message transfer between network nodes to support the necessary quality of service, including predictable times and jitter. Second, in case of network failures, it must support dynamic adaptation of the rules through the networks. And finally, it must support generation of rules for the switches, includes the set of rules includes the rules for checking the traffic for conformance to SLA requirements, the routing rules, and the rules for traffic shaping. Finally, this is the table which compares the three considered approaches. We can see that given the ability to provide deterministic timings and jitter, the SDN based on the open flow has some bonuses over fiber channel, and AFDX as an obsolete and aged standard has several drawbacks, which makes it quite unusable for system with dynamic modes of operations and for cases of network or computational node failures. So I think that a killer feature of SDVM with its controller and its applications is the ability to support dynamic mode changes, including failure modes of system operation. And according to other criterions, the SDM goes on par with fiber channel based on with its real-time profile. And so the future work includes development of an open flow profile for onboard systems, which includes only the necessary features, because the simpler is the implementation of the protocol, the more reliable it is. Second, the time synchronization facilities must be implemented, for example, based on EDP protocol. The controller application must be developed, and a methodology for end-to-end delay and jitter estimations is to be provided. That's it. Thank you for your attention.
So thank you very much. Questions?
Do you consider your system, onboard system, as autonomous isolated, or it may be integrated in the more larger network?
This approach is suitable both for autonomous system, for example, for autonomous aircraft and for piloted aircraft or human-controlled technical systems. The pilot is involved as one of the sources of control actions, nothing more.
Question. You said that the SDN networking will prevent us from duplicating the network. And what about duplicating the controller and making the level of availability? Thank you.
The necessary amount of network hardware duplication depends on the mode of network operation. If we consider the active mode, then the controller and the control network has to be completely duplicated, because there is an endless stream of information from the switches to the controller. But if we consider passive mode, in which the controller is much less involved, then I think no complete duplication is necessary, at least in case the system is okay to operate in a single mode. And regarding the duplication of data network, it must not be strictly complete, because the network application on the controller can calculate an alternative route around the file link without necessary complete physical duplication, as it is usual with AFDX and file chain of real time.
Okay, thank you very much, Vasya. Thank you.